Well, good morning or good afternoon, depending where you are around the world. I'm Steve Darling from Proactive, here with another live stream event, live from our studios in Vancouver, British Columbia. Excited to talk a little bit more about what's been happening with Nextech3D.ai. Yes, that is the brand new name, and we're going to be learning a lot about what's going on within the company and also what's going on as far as the parts of the company as well. So let's get things underway. Just before we do that, we should also mention that if you do want to ask a question, we'll be monitoring both the chat on YouTube and also the chat in this webinar as well. And you're welcome to throw in any questions you would like, and we'll pose those to our guests. Coming up a little later on, we're going to talk with Dasha Vdovina, the Chief Product Officer for Toggle3D, and as well, Shadnam Khan, who's the head of product for ARway. So lots to come in this next chat we have. And let's bring in the man himself, the architect, you might say, of what was Nextech AR Solutions, and now, as I mentioned, Nextech3D.ai, Evan Gappelberg. And Evan, it's always great to see you, my friend. Thank you very much for coming along with us today.
Great to see you, Steve. I don't know if you noticed, I'm wearing a blue shirt today. One of my investors, long-term investor, said, you know, you always wear black. Do you have any other shirts? And I'm like, you know, okay, let's go blue today.
Perfect. You're good to go.
I see you're wearing a black jacket though. Nice look there. So we switched off a little.
I was doing it for you. I thought you were going to wear black too, but next time, no problem. Evan, I thought it'd be a great opportunity for you and I, before we bring in members of your team, just to sort of have a little chat about where the company's at. And I mentioned specifically about the name change, Nextech3D.ai. And I know that you and I talked about that recently, and you really felt that this is the launch of where the company is going in the future.
Yeah, look, Steve, and really to all of our investors that are watching and paying attention, we are at a key inflection point. There's been an enormous amount of change, positive changes going on at Nextech, really over the past couple of years, preparing for this moment in time. I think the most important topic really for us to cover is our technology and our customers, but really Amazon is the key customer. We talk a lot about Amazon, but I just want to put some statistics out there to put a finer point on how big Amazon really is to Nextech and really to the entire United States of America. It's not just a Nextech story. Amazon has 70 million households that have a Prime subscription. 70 million households is a huge number. I don't know any other company, you know, I don't know, maybe Netflix can compete on that scale. Amazon really dominates the United States e-com market. They are the dominant player. There really is nobody that comes close. They have a catalog of 12 million products across all categories and services. If you factor in the Amazon Marketplace, they have 353 million products. Now, the reason why that's important is that all those products, 353 million, are being converted from 2D photos into 3D models. And that is the business that Nextech has with Amazon. And, you know, we could go into all the different details, but that isn't even stagnant. You know, when you think about it, Steve, that's today. Amazon is growing. Amazon's going to double in size over the next decade. And if you look at Amazon, there really is nobody that comes close to them. I was just, you know, again, doing a little research. And if you look at, let's say, Walmart in comparison, Walmart's like 10% the size, 10%. And Walmart's huge, right? Yeah. But it's just Amazon is just that big a Goliath. And Nextech signed Amazon as a customer. We're now, you know, the preferred 3D model supplier in just Q3 2022. So now we're in Q1. 2023, and mm-hmm. It's, you know, a couple months in, and that relationship is a key piece to our future. It's a key piece to understanding the Nextech story. It's not the only part of the story, but when you have a customer that big, it is worth putting the spotlight on them, because no matter what any of our other customers do, whether it's Walmart or Target or CB2 or Napa, we talk about a lot of customers on your show. They're all just drops in the bucket, really, when you compare them to Amazon. And so I want to put that out there as a spotlight.
Someone asked a question, so I want to specifically about that. And the question relates to something you mentioned in a previous video, talking about, you know, Amazon looking for a number of suppliers. But as you mentioned, you're a preferred supplier. So how do you continue to make sure that Nextech is looked at first before anybody else?
So let's be clear. Nobody, not Nextech or any company, can be a sole source supplier for Amazon for 3D modeling. It's just not reality, right? So we are a preferred supplier. They've told us repeatedly that they only have a handful. That means it's like five. We're not a handful, right? We're not talking about buckets. We're not talking about hundreds of companies. There's only a handful. It's a lot of work dealing with Amazon. When you're dealing with a 1,000-pound gorilla, it's not easy. You know, we have a team that services Amazon, and they're very high tech. They require a very high level of service, and there are very few companies that can achieve that. We are one of a handful of companies. So when it comes to, you know, continuing to service them, we meet with them every day. We have checkups every week. You know, I'm on calls with them every other week. And so we're in constant contact with Amazon. We have an amazingly positive relationship with them. And we really see nothing but growth opportunities. And I just want to bring one last point up about Amazon, and then we switch to technology. And that is that Amazon corporate has been seeding the market and buying 3D models directly from Nextech. Amazon has millions of merchants. Let me just pull up. I was just looking, you know, in some of the stats online, like how many merchants does Amazon actually have? And it's just actually a massive number. Amazon has 10 million sellers. 10 million. That's a lot of sellers. Those are people that have, you know, signed up to Amazon's account to sell product. And that's, you know, just a lot of potential customers that are going to be looking for 3D models. To put that into perspective, we've only maybe serviced a couple of hundred globally. I'm talking, you know, like since we've been in, you know, supplying 3D models, is like a couple of hundred customers.
Yeah.
Amazon has millions. It's like, you know, we're down here and it's all the way. It's like Mount Everest. The number of, you can't see to the top of the mountain, right? And so from our perspective, that's our growth. And right now, the door for all those customers to buy product from Nextech is currently closed, but about to open. And therein lies the opportunity that we're so excited about. This is why we come to work every day. This is why we've been building our tech to be able to scale the production of 3D models. It's because of this mountain of demand, all these customers that Amazon, you know, is basically the gatekeeper to. And so they're opening that door in the next couple of weeks. They've told us by the end of the month and then into April. And when that door opens, they're going to be given an option to buy 3D models from Nextech or a handful of other 3D modelers. And so my feeling is that as we roll into Q2, the demand is going to go through the roof for our 3D models just from Amazon. This has nothing to do with Target or Walmart or CB2 or any of those other guys. Now, I do think, Steve, we also want to talk about the tech.
Yeah.
That's the other thing I want to spotlight.
Okay.
Just the demand. Yeah.
On the tech, just because we're flooded with questions, and because every time you talk, people want to ask questions. So I want to get to the tech like really quickly, but there's been four or five questions in the same topic. So, and I think it really bodes well because you're talking about the opportunity that you have with the 3D model. Is that the path to cash positive?
It 100%.
I think that's what people want to know is when you talk about the opportunities.
We are laser focused on the cash to profitability and going cash flow positive.
Yeah.
Amazon, that look, it's just a numbers game at the end of the day, right? What does it cost us to produce? What's the demand? And then, you know, how much money are we left with after we sell these 3D models? And then, you know, that goes to pay our amazing team and reinvest back into our tech. Okay. So the equation is getting very, very bullish for Nextech because of the technology and the demand. So the demand is literally right there. It's already starting to rise up, but the tech piece is the game changer. And I think you had Nima Shazar, our CTO, on earlier talking about a patent that we filed. You know, when we file a patent, that doesn't mean that we're waiting for that patent to be approved to use the tech. We're using the tech today. We're using AI today to increase our ability to produce 3D models at scale, which brings our costs down. To put it into perspective, it used to take us like, you know, when we first started coming on your show, Steve, back in 2019, mm-hmm. it would take us like 2 weeks to make a 3D model. 2 weeks. Last year, we were able to get it down to, I don't know, a day for a complex 3D model. You know, sometimes, and then towards the end of the year, we were able to get it down to a couple hours.
Mm-hmm.
Now, entering the age where AI is going to allow us to produce 3D models in minutes, that's less than an hour. That is what's going to happen is, you know, it's like it just swings our profitability way, way up there where previously, you know, it was difficult to make money because people are only going to pay so much for a 3D model. There is a limit. There's a limit, right? So, you know, that limit is set by the market. Now, with our costs going down because of AI, our profitability is going up. And basically, that opens up the floodgates because more demand is going to show up. I mean, it's business 101, Steve,
right?
With new industries. You always have... You know, you start off where things are expensive. I mean, I remember when my cell phone bill was, you know, $500 a month for, and you'd have to buy minutes, mm-hmm. right? And then now you get like unlimited for, I don't know, what does it cost? You know, unlimited you could get for, you know, I think there's some.
$100, yeah.
Yeah, a couple $100 for the family plan. But
yeah.
I think individuals can get like unlimited for like $10 or something. And so, and what happens is that it opens it up. Like in the beginning, only people mm-hmm. that are willing to spend, you know, top dollar can get the tech, right? You get the early adopters, the pioneers. And then over time, as the price comes down, the market widens. And we're kind of at the point where the market is actually widening. The price hasn't really started to come down yet, which means we're going to be able to reap some really significant profits off of you know, this business, which is super exciting for us.
Yeah. Okay. Two questions. One is someone asked a really good question here about do you do too much R&D right now in order to maybe scale the current products you have and not do R&D moving forward? Can you sort of address that? Because I think the R&D, I think people understand, because you really, the company has just a number of products within their stack, and the R&D is really to enhance those particular products. Am I reading that right?
So The right now we have a number of major R&D projects underway. They're all geared towards one thing, and that is towards increasing profitability, lowering cost, increasing scale, which ultimately means that we become more profitable. The focus of the company is, you know, we're keeping our eye on our customers and what our customers are asking for. And they're essentially asking for more 3D models, you know, scale. And so from our standpoint, we're investing in AI, specifically generative AI, that's going to allow us to have an end-to-end AI solution that, you know, shrinks the time from here to here, which means our profitability goes up here. It's just, it's simple math. Like, you know, I mean, it's hard to explain, you know, with words. Maybe I'll bring a chart on next time.
No, I think, and on that question, my second question on that, I think is timely because it's right in the right spot. What is the sweet spot for generating 3D models? Because you mentioned, you know, it was at, you know, 2 weeks, and then it was a week, and then it was a day, and then it was in a couple of hours. Is it 5 minutes? Is it 3 minutes? Is it 10 minutes? Is it a half hour? Like, do you have a thought of how you can get to that point where you start to speed them up, so you produce them so quickly that the, is there a sweet spot, or have you found that?
There is. We're gearing up for that in like Q4 of this year. There's another, so, you know, think of it as tech that needs to be built. I mean, you could think of a car, you know, you got to build the engine, you know, you got the doors, you got the windshield, you know, there's different parts to the car, right? So right now, our car is able to go and, you know, we have, let's just say, an eight cylinder. Okay, that's not enough. I want a 12 cylinder twin turbo engine that's going to allow us to really go and not stop, right? Where the production, when you talk about how fast, well, if you think about end-to-end AI, you have simple models, medium models, complex models. The simple models can be spit out. I mean, it might end up being seconds. It might be seconds. It might not even be minutes. The simple, talking simple stuff. Okay. Medium, it's going to be a couple of minutes. Complex, a couple of minutes more, right? And those minutes are going to shrink down as the AI gets smarter. Because remember, artificial intelligence is all about this algorithm that keeps learning, it keeps improving. So there is going to be a point where, you know, the models are going to be potentially made in seconds. And so, but, you know, at the end of the day, Steve, I think once our tech is built, it's going to be hard for me to imagine that somebody, maybe it's an Amazon, doesn't just say, you know what, we're just going to plug this into our platform. You know, why are we outsourcing? We're just going to plug it in. And it just becomes part of the Amazon experience. You literally show up, you show a picture to the AI of your product, and like magic, it spits out a 3D model that's to spec. And that goes up on Amazon's site. I mean, I have to believe that in the future, that's where all of this ends up.
Okay. All right. We got to move along. Now, there are obviously questions. Every time you and I get together, you get these questions about, you know, the stock price and what's going to, you know, spending and what's going to be the future and all that. We'll talk about sort of that at the end, because I think that's something to leave everybody with. But we should bring in a couple of your guests that you've brought along with you today. Yeah. We're going to start with ARway, and obviously it's been spun out. Shadnam Khan is with us today. You want to introduce Shadnam and just tell us a bit about him?
Yeah. I just want to set the stage. Shadnam's been with me for how long has it been, Shad?
2.5 years.
2.5 years. So that's quite a long time to be working at Nextech. Lots of changes happened over the past 2.5 years. And Shadnam is now Chief Product Officer for ARway. He's essentially, you know, bringing that product to market. All the hard work that he's been doing behind the scenes has allowed us to launch that product. You know, he's not the guy building it. There's a whole nother team, but he is kind of the architect in terms of designing the features and functionality, right? There's a whole team behind him. He basically says, hey, we need, you know, you guys to build this, right? And so he's a key player. He's also been involved in a lot of the sales calls. He talks to customers. He listens to what they want. And so he's got a lot of knowledge. You know, other than myself, he's probably the most knowledgeable person at ARway about the tech, about the business. And so I thought it would be a good thing to introduce him today so that he can speak to what's happening at ARway. And with that, I think he's got a little bit of a deck.
So you can, Evan, you can shut your camera off and grab a drink and take a couple of minutes, grab some water. And then Shadnam, I'll let you sort of share with everyone and give some thoughts. And then we'll come back on and have a little conversation at the end. Okay.
Amazing. Thank you, Steve. It's great to be here today with you folks. I'm sure you guys have been hearing lots about ARway, and I appreciate any sort of questions you have sort of under the hood around the technology, about customers, and how we're going to market. Quick primer for folks who might be new in this call. ARway provides an augmented reality-based spatial computing platform. Lots of use cases in there, but you know, our core differentiating factor is providing spatial computing features with zero to no code, essentially. What do we mean by spatial computing? The way we interact with computers is changing completely. For the last decade or more, the last 50 years even, we have been restricted to interacting with computers in two-dimensional worlds, which is a screen at the end of the day. You can imagine how restrictive that is, considering that the real world is in 3D. Spatial computing is the suite of technologies that allows you 6 degrees of freedom when you're interacting with digital content. We'll get to more on that in a bit, but what we're finding a lot of success in with ARway in the early days is in the wayfinding area, getting people from point A to B. We have spatials. These are all interactive AR experiences beyond just static filters and products and whatnot. It's essentially populating a physical space with digital content that you can interact with 6 degrees of freedom. We also do audiovisual guided tours, lots of use cases in there. And a key part of that that ties everything together is the location intelligence. Being an app-based solution allows us to capture a lot of location-based data of how people are behaving in specific properties and places. So there's a gold mine of data that allows marketers, advertisers, property managers, and all to harvest it for various use cases. Think of improving the facilities, improving the services, as well as providing them with hyper-local content that is very relevant to that specific location. With our spatial computing platform, there are sort of two key markets that opened up for us. There is no like-for-like solution for ARway that we see in any of these markets. The big impact we're having is on the global indoor positioning and navigation market. It's at $44 billion of market size and growing 42% at a compounded annual growth rate. The reason why we're finding success in this is because we're disrupting the existing technology base that the customers in that industry are used to. They're used to having large deployment life cycles, buying expensive hardware, lots of operating costs to manage it. And the way that they manage these maps are very tedious. So putting a spatial computing platform in that space revolutionizes and greatly increases the user experience that visitors in a property has. That's where we're seeing quite a lot of success. On the flip side of things, there is an existing augmented reality software market. You can think of these as AR SDKs. AR Core by Google, AR Kit by Apple are the major players here. But then there is a lot of contenders in there with Vuforia, Unity. And these are essentially platforms that allow to create AR experiences. I want to bring up a few key stats that allows you to understand how massive a combination of these opportunities is essentially. So there are 600 million active mobile devices today with AR capabilities. And there are 4.5 million apps in the Google App and Apple Play, Apple App Store and Google Play Stores. Why do we not see many apps with AR capabilities? It's because all these reasons we have been targeting. It's very expensive to maintain. It's 3D model creation is very, very difficult. And location persistence is very difficult to achieve. We probably see, you know, Pokemon Go and Snap as the true flag bearers of AR mobile apps with AR capabilities. What ARway has done is essentially taken away a lot of the pain in creating AR applications. We have an SDK that allows any app developer, any mobile app to have AR functionalities in there, but they're powerful functionalities which are AI driven. Competitive differentiation, as I said, there's not a like for like competitor, which allows us to be in two places at one. And I'll talk about the customers and you'll see where the convergence really lies. But some of the key things I do want to mention is location persistence at scale. You previously would require satellite technology, ultra wideband, Bluetooth beacons to position specific content exactly at the exact geo coordinates. Indoors, it's even more difficult because, you know, satellite technology doesn't penetrate into, you know, the basements of buildings or can't recognize floors. That location persistence is allowing us to, you know, increase our reach in AR apps that are not just specifically outdoors. You probably have played Pokemon Go and captured Pokemon in large facilities and mostly outdoor areas. ARway allows you to pinpoint exactly where that is. The other factor why we're seeing a lot of positive impact in the navigation market is previously, and we hear this from customers quite a bit, previously wayfinding was seen as like a cost center. It was something that you invested tons of money and the ROI was hard to quantify. It was a must-have for a facilities manager. Our solution takes wayfinding and navigation from a cost center to a revenue center for a customer. Not only are they able to provide the wayfinding services and the capabilities, they're also able to monetize on it. It gives a lot of authority and power to facilities and operations managers in large facilities to deploy these solutions, as well as engage lots of cross-functional stakeholders to use the platform. Having said all that, all roads lead to one. I'm sure you're seeing we're signing up a lot of agency deals. A lot of agencies are using our platform, but all roads lead to the same place. It's these real world locations that the enterprise customers want to deploy ARway. It's the same locations where agencies are trying to go. So we are a platform solution end to end. We choose both those channels. Marketers see AR as a new medium to publish content and monetize eyeballs with. Facility managers and these properties see AR as an enhanced user experience that provides them more brand value and engagement. And the proof is in the pudding. There's been massive growth in adoption of ARway. 727% active users who are using very limited functionality of ARway and trying to figure out the best use cases to go to their enterprise clients with. On the other side, we have 25 pilots today. I think we just, as we started this call, we just closed another pilot as we speak. So massive growth in folks trying out a paid version and getting eyeballs in there and getting measuring customer engagement there. AI is key over here. When you are navigating or even in an AR experience, you're walking around, there are millions of calculations that are AI drives to position you accurately in a space. This is a core value proposition. We are a no hardware based solution. Our software is what takes us to the next level. So with that, I'll leave it open to questions and any comments, and I will try and address them to the best of my abilities.
Yeah, so we do have some questions for you. And someone asked about pilots and how many pilots you had underway. So obviously you've mentioned that you have 25 pilots there, and you can stop sharing your screen when you get a second. There was also some questions around MAPD. Can you talk about MAPD?
Sure. So MAPD is an event management solution specifically targeted at trade show organizers. There is lots of synergies between MAPD and ARway. MAPD creates floor plans, which act as inputs to ARway to populate that space with content. So we're cross-pollinating our client base as we speak. We did a large show, Synapse Conference, just late in February, where they were using both MAPD and ARway capabilities.
Yeah. Another one, how long would a pilot run for? Do they vary?
Yeah, so it depends on the industry, but typically between 30 to 90 days, the time it takes for you to capture a lot of location intelligence for you to monetize your space. If you think of a place like an airport where there is a lot of, throughfare of people, you're able to collect a really good data set within a week, essentially. You talk about a mall, it scales down a bit, you'd need a larger amount of time to collect that data. Mm-hmm. It all depends, and we're amenable and flexible to support pilots of all natures.
Yeah, somebody mentioned sports stadium. So is that one that you might need a few games to sort of understand the usages of it?
Absolutely, yeah. So in a stadium, we like to think of stadiums as multi-purpose venues. Stadiums not only host games, they also host concerts. One of the key differentiating factors we spoke about was map management, right? Like, you don't have to code and do a lot of, somersaults to change up a map for different events at a venue. If a stadium is hosting events, games, guided tours, any of those events, like, that's also great data for ARway to provide location intelligence with.
Okay. Another question here about competition. Where do you see your competition coming from? And is the fact that you have no code, no hardware, what does that do for the company?
Absolutely. So there is, like I mentioned, there is no like-for-like competitor out there. If you look at, I put up two different markets there. If I just look at the AR SDK and software development market in there, a lot of AR activations that you see are essentially one-to-one. If you look at Nextech's core ARway 3D, the core product, you scan a QR code and you'll essentially see one AR experience, which might be a 3D model or just a limited environment. And that's where the market is. What ARway does is it provides location persistence at scale. One QR code scan or one flip of a button, your entire facility becomes an AR environment with content in there. So that's a very big differentiating factor that, to our knowledge, we're not seeing any of our competitors tackling.
Just to add to what Shad's saying, that is a technological advancement. I mean, there's a company called Eighth Wall that was acquired by Niantic, which is, they have like almost a $10 billion valuation. They're the Pokemon Go guys. They basically pioneered this whole augmented reality spatial computing kind of experience, but they use technology, which Shad can speak to, which is, point cloud technology, which we started out using, but we found that there was a lot of flaws in that technology and it wasn't actually something that could scale easily. So we pivoted to some groundbreaking new technology. And that's really what we have today. I think we just heard the other day that a Niantic customer is leaving Niantic to work on the ARway platform for this exact reason. So okay. We're actually taking some market share from the incumbent.
All right. And on that, someone was asking about, so pilot, is the key to the success of ARway now is getting the pilots done and then transferring them into clients long-term? Is that a focus of the company?
Definitely, yes. If you see the innovation lifecycle here, you have these active users that use a small amount of capabilities, specifically the location persistence, and they convert into pilots where they want to build these large scale experiences. Mm-hmm. Each of our pilots come with terms where, based on specific KPIs that they have, you know, focused on, they convert into paying monthly recurring customers that have a system running in there. It's also important to note that ARway is not a point solution. ARway integrates with their tech ecosystem. If you go to a shopping mall, it integrates with loyalty programs because they run ads through those platforms. If you go into a retail location, like let's say a grocery store, it integrates with their inventory management systems because they want to update the location of products in one system. So we, with the pilots, we become part of the ecosystems of all the industries we work with.
Okay, got it. And last question for you before you let you go, Shad, is someone wants to know, and Evan, you can jump in on this one as well. Does ARway someday get its own CEO? And Shad, would you like to apply? Because you've been killing it today, my friend, doing well.
Yeah, maybe Shad will be the next CEO. You never know. You know, look, I'm an interim CEO, right? The company's only been public since October. The key is not necessarily me. The key is the team behind me. And I'm here to make sure that the team gets off the runway and really that the business takes off. Once that happens, all of our investors can be reassured that a new CEO will magically appear and I will magically disappear.
There you go. Well, speaking of that, Shad, it's time for you to disappear. Thank you very much. Really appreciate your time. Yeah, very interesting stuff, and enjoy it. And thanks very much.
Yeah, nice job, Shad. Thank you.
Yeah, really good. Okay, let's bring in quickly becoming one of my favorite employees. Shad was great, and Dasha as well. And I really enjoyed talking to Dasha. Incredibly smart and knows the technology inside and out. Dasha Vdovina is the Chief Product Officer with Toggle3D. Evan, you want to say a couple words about Dasha?
I do. Hold on one second. I see her hat, and it makes me want to put on my hat. As soon as I see, yeah, she's got the hat.
The Toggle 3D hat, yes.
Yeah, Dasha has basically, you know, been working we've had her on your show a couple of times. She's Chief Product Officer for Toggle 3D. In case our investors don't know this, we have Chief Product Officers for every one of our products because it's different skill sets and somebody really needs to be 100% focused on the product. And the product is a very complex thing. It sounds super simple. What people see in the end, it's like, oh, you know, it's so simple. But the thought, the work that goes into building these products is intense. And yeah, it is something amazing that Dasha has been creating with Toggle 3D. There is a team behind her, you know, so there is no one person, but Dasha is definitely leading the charge, waving the flag. She is on the front lines and she's having a tremendous amount of early success. So we love success and we love to see success at Nextech. And with that, I'll let her take it away.
Okay, Dasha, we'll shut off our cameras and then we'll come back on, ask a couple of questions at the end, okay?
Awesome, sounds good. So similar to Shad, I do have a presentation to share. Sharing my screen here now. Okay, awesome. So we'll jump right into it. So for those that may not have heard of Toggle 3D just yet, it is our web-based design studio for converting, texturing, customizing, and sharing high-quality 3D models. And this is all done on one platform. What makes Toggle 3D really unique is the approach that we took to make 3D modeling very easy, very accessible, and ultimately democratizing the place altogether in the industry. Well, how we've done this is through this template-based approach. So to get started with Toggle 3D, it's simple. You sign in and you have templates to get you started. Depending on what your visualization goal is, we tailor the design editor to meet your goals so that you're not flooded with all of these panels and tools and sliders that you don't know you even need or maybe you don't need at all. But instead, we make these tools available to you based on what your visualization goals are. And that leads into the second point, where it's built for anybody, no matter your 3D experience, no matter if you've never modeled in 3D before, or you're an experienced artist, Toggle3D takes the complexity out of the experience and makes it easy. When things are easy, things are fast. The third point here is the AI-powered creation methods that we have on the platform. And this is ultimately what helps us not only scale 3D model creation, but that's the part that makes Toggle3D super easy. Again, we're taking all the complexity and putting it into the back door. You don't really even see what happens. From the user's point of view, you just tell us what you want, provide us a reference image, ask or answer a couple questions, and ultimately the AI will do it for you. And then lastly, scalability. And this is the bread and butter of Toggle3D, because the way that we scale 3D content creation is starting from CAD files. So for those that may not be familiar with CAD files, what they are is they're the manufacturing, the heavy manufacturing files that are behind pretty much every product you see around you today in the physical world. These files are very heavy, and for that reason, they're sort of boxed into very specialized software programs. But Toggle3D is taking that, and we're making them really lightweight, web-friendly models. And because they're web-friendly, all of a sudden they become distributable. So on the point of market size for Toggle3D, Toggle3D fits into the industry of global computer graphics imagery market, the CGI market. The CGI market is expected to reach $160 billion by 2027, growing at a rate of 5.8% over the forecasted period. And I will say much of this growth is attributed to this shift from 2D to 3D that we're seeing. So the designers that are in this industry, they don't want to design in 2D anymore. They want to go to 3D. And something that we say inside the team is, you know, our physical world's in 3D. So why would the digital not be? Thus far, before this metaverse trend that has been arising, most of our digital world has been in 2D. So on that note, then, the application software market in the CGI industry, this is what we're talking about when we say CAD software. They're in this industry. You also see your digital video software, your imaging software, modeling, animation. These are all the different players that are in the field. So the question you might have then is, where does Toggle3D fit into this? Toggle3D is that bridge between the engineering side of the industry, so these CAD softwares, and the art side of the industry, the modeling, the animation, the digital software. Toggle3D is bridging that gap and using what you already have that already exists in the engineering world and making it applicable to the design, the art world of it. So now that we sort of know what the softwares are in the industry, how does Toggle3D differentiate? Well, to use the current software, the legacy systems in the industry, you need a very specialized skill set. This is not sort of a, I want to try it out, so I'm going to download the software. Ultimately, unless you're studying to be an expert in the software or you're working in the industry, you're never really going to sign in to, let's say, Autodesk or Blender or Adobe and just give it a shot, because it is not that easy. However, Toggle3D is. Toggle3D is, you log in, you have your templates, your setup, you don't even have to know anything about 3D modeling, and you definitely don't need to know how to use Toggle3D. We guide you through that process. The other point is that these softwares are very expensive, which is another reason you're not just going to try it out and, you know, potentially watch yourself fail. Toggle3D is affordable. There's no barriers to entry, and we set you up that you don't fail. So when you do sign into Toggle, you have your guided workflows, you have the tools available to you as you need, and ultimately from signing onto the platform until you reach your first 3D visualization goal, it's minutes between that process. Then we also have this AI-powered creation method. So we've talked about this a little bit earlier in the other slide, but this is what makes Toggle3D very easy. The next point here we have is that Toggle3D is a web-based application. What that means is it's in your browser. There's no such thing as downloading a desktop app or, you know, having to figure out, does this work for my system? Does this work for my computer? Ultimately, if you have access to the internet and the web, you have access to Toggle3D. And the really great thing about this is then this web-based application lends itself very well to collaboration. So whether you're a B2B manufacturer or B2C, it lets you collaborate with both inside your team, but also with your clients as you go ahead and design that product. And then lastly, this is one platform that will do it all. When we're talking to our early adopters today, they're telling us that to go from CAD files to the web-friendly version of a 3D model that can then be used for AR, VR purposes, they're jumping between 4 to 6 different softwares. So let's say you wanted to enter and try out one of these legacy systems. You're not just going to be learning one of them. You're going to be learning 6 different variations of that process. In Toggle3D, it's an all-in-one solution. So what we like to say, again, another quote from the team here is, our goal with Toggle3D is to do what Canva did to the 2D design world. So we are disrupting 3D design the same way Canva disrupted 2D design. And if you compare the user bases of Canva today versus Adobe, which is also in the 2D graphic market, Canva has 4 times the amount of users that Adobe does. And the reason is they've made 2D design accessible. So let's just hone in on this aspect of the CAD file just for a really quick second here, because there's something really kind of incredible that's going on here with Toggle3D and the CAD file industry. So CAD files, as I mentioned, they used to be locked inside of these specialized programs, and you can't really take them out of that program because they are very heavy. We're talking about over 1,000 megabytes oftentimes. So what Toggle3D does is it turns that CAD file into the engine for 3D. So rather than having the CAD file sort of end there at the manufacturing software level, we are unlocking its potential and letting it be the engine for different sections of the product lifecycle. So think about it this way. One CAD file, now that it's unlocked to the web, it has endless opportunities. And let's just talk about a couple of them here really quickly. Product design. So CAD files, CAD software, they don't let you sort of add the photorealistic, high quality materials or textures on your, like the geometry that you're manufacturing. So you could take the geometry here, convert it to the web with Toggle3D, and then add our high quality textures and materials and see it in AR as you're making your design decisions. The second point here is customization. So we talked about the use case of B2B manufacturers or B2C manufacturers. Oftentimes we're seeing that a lot of their products are customizable. They have different product variations and options that their end consumer can choose. But it's really hard to visualize all of these different options if you don't have an easy way of doing it. So with Toggle3D, you make one 3D model, you assign multiple material options to it, and you can showcase and work with your client so that they can choose and tell you what they want before you even go ahead and quote them and manufacture it for them. Then we have the use case of e-commerce. This is the one that we know and love at Nextech. This is all about taking your product, making it into 3D, putting it on your product page, and then ultimately letting the end consumer engage with it and try before they buy, ultimately leading to increased conversions and decreased returns. Then we have product marketing and ads. So today, if you wanted to, all of your marketing content, your collateral, the brochures, the beautiful images you see on the website, most of those are done in a real studio. So it's about taking the product into a studio, having a professional photographer take different pictures of it, different angles, editing, and providing you with a, let's say 10, 20, 30 images of your product. And ultimately, you're paying tens of thousands of dollars for that process. Instead, you can take that 3D model, put all your high quality materials on it, stage it in a virtual environment, and do that exact same process, but in a virtual environment, and render it in 4K. All of a sudden, you're saving time, you're saving money, and you have these beautiful images to show for it. And then lastly, really quickly, here's the 3D modeling. So this is a very broad use case, but we see that it lends itself very well. And our early adopters are making 3D models for different use cases. Some of it is gaming. The other is staging these virtual environments. Another one is the VR sort of application that we're seeing in the metaverse environment as well. And all of these different use cases, they're all unlocked with one CAD file. I mean, I've told you how incredible that the product is, where it fits in the market, but let's let some of the numbers do the talking. So we've seen a lot of early success for the product. We had a soft launch at the end of September, but it was very alpha, it was conceptual. We didn't have any marketing put towards or anything like that. It was really testing the industry. Since then, we've done an official, very sort of confident beta launch January 19th. And today on the platform, we have over 710 beta users for Toggle3D. That is a 647% increase since the beginning of the year. Among those beta users, they've already created over 950 designs on Toggle3D. The other really awesome thing is that these early adopters, we see a pretty even split between experienced 3D artists and new entrants. What that means for us is that not only are we capturing market share from the legacy software businesses that are already in the 3D world, but we're also seeing new entrants enter the industry. These are people that would have never thought themselves to be 3D artists. And as I mentioned in the very beginning, that's what we want to do with Toggle3D. We want to make 3D design accessible. And we're seeing this through our early adopters. Those that would have never said, you know, I'm a 3D artist, if Toggle3D didn't exist today. And the last two points here, these highlight the technological advances that were brewing in our R&D division. And these are ultimately what are gonna help us get out of beta very, very soon and launch sort of the official big product launch. The first part here is that we have found a way to reduce the CAD file size to as much as 95%. So again, if we're talking about files that are over 1,000 megabytes, those aren't gonna load anywhere close in the web world. But if we're able to reduce them by 95%, then not only do you have faster loading, but you have a better user experience and a lot of a friendlier 3D model to work with. And then lastly, we have a lot of success in our R&D lab to convert files that are much larger than we publicly allow users to convert today, as much as 10 times larger. That means that not only are we able to deal with higher and larger manufacturing files, but this also opens up the world of enterprise for us because a lot of these enterprise manufacturers, their files are that large. So that kind of segments our way into that industry as well and ultimately into signing those enterprise level accounts. So with that, I'll leave it off for the presentation and see if there's any questions to follow.
Awesome. Really great job. Good stuff. And you can stop sharing your screen and we'll move in here and great stuff. And just think you could take Evan's high school photos and reduce them by 95%. It's really is truly incredible. A couple of questions for you, Dasha, before we let you go. Was this an industry in dealing with CAD files that was really ripe for technological advancement?
Yeah, exactly. So these CAD files already exist today, right? So the really great thing about, and the reason that Toggle is able to scale so quickly with the 3D content creation piece of it is because we're using things that already exist, but that used to be locked up in specialized software. So by unlocking them, we're essentially repurposing what's already out there, but allowing for all these different use cases to form around that one CAD file.
Okay. What major players in the CAD world are you aware of that use this type of technology?
Yeah, so Autodesk, we saw them on the list. We have Dassault Systems on the list, Fusion 360. There's a lot of sort of CAD software, and we're not necessarily replacing the CAD software. We're not trying to, you know, have people make their own products from scratch on Toggle. They're not doing the engineering work on Toggle. But they're taking the engineering work that's been done and they're converting it. Or otherwise, again, like as I was saying, they would be locked in these systems that you couldn't take them out of. So there is a lot of stuff that has to be done on top of that CAD file in order to get it to a place where it's manufacturable, you have your design decisions made, and you're able to repurpose it. So some of these players, like the Autodesk and whatnot, they do have a conversion from this native CAD software, but it's not very good. And that's exactly why we see a lot of these experienced 3D artists coming to us and saying, you know, this is revolutionary, the way that you're able to convert CAD, because there's so much that can go wrong in that conversion process. And we've pretty much figured it out. So that's kind of the main reason that there is that other step after the CAD file has been made and we're tackling that part of the 3D world.
Okay. And last question, and that is, How do you, is it a lot of word of mouth that you get to understand the companies that deal with Toggle3D in order to get the product out to as many people as you can? And can they test the product first? Is that the idea?
Yes, exactly. So Toggle3D, our goal is virality. The way that we're doing this is through a freemium business model. So you can start using Toggle completely free and it's going to be free forever. There are limitations to the free plan, but you have just enough to figure out what Toggle3D is all about and then how you can use Toggle3D to scale your visualization needs. So actually, that's the business model that has let us reach a lot of success because, as you were saying exactly, it's word of mouth. It's people talking to their friends in the industry, and then their friends in the industry are pitching it to their executive team to say, you know, we need to use this. We've tested it. We love it. So it's exactly that. It's starting from the users and having the users do the rest for us.
All right. Dasha, thank you so much. Really well done. Really gave a some good insight into what's going on at Toggle3D. And it sounds like it's been going well so far since the official launch. So Evan, another great team member you introduced us to today.
I know. Well, I was going to say, great job, Dasha. All my team members make me look great. You know, it's not. I'm just happy that everybody is really living their dream at Nextech. That's really always been important to me. And if anyone's actually listening to what Dasha's saying, I'm going to try and interpret some of it, you know, for our investors. You know, if you back to like all the CAD files are like trapped in these big, let's just call them mainframes almost, you know, these giant computers. And so, but think about the billions of eyeballs that are on the web every day. That's the market that we're able to take these CAD files to from these kind of engineering, you know, like techie platforms to the World Wide Web. That's just a huge, huge opportunity. And that's really one of the things we're cracking. And then, you know, this idea that we could texture a 3D model after it gets imported onto Toggle3D. That's where ARtize3D starts to benefit in a big way because it's not just CAD files. Dasha's talked a lot about CAD files, but we've actually, what is it, the GLB files, we're able to also import those, right, Dasha?
Yeah, exactly. Other file 3D file formats as well.
Yeah. And so anything 3D can be brought into the Toggle platform. And then it's point and click. You know, remember when we were talking about the you know, used to take hours and then minutes and go into seconds? Toggle3D is actually the engine that's allowing us to do a lot of that, where the AI is just getting better and better. So all of our technology is kind of interconnected and intertwined. And really, we're leveraging it throughout the company. But yeah, super exciting. One last thing, Steve.
Yeah.
We are spinning out Toggle3D. So Toggle3D will go public. Of course, I am going to be the CEO again temporarily. So all of our investors, you know, they should know that. But
Dasha, get your resume in is what you're saying?
Yeah. I'm saying, you know, these things are going to take a little bit of time to manifest themselves in the market. But then obviously there will be somebody else who will be the CEO, and you never know, it could be Dasha. We could end up coming back here where it's Evan, Dasha, Shadnam. You never know, you know, these things, only the future is going to tell, right? The future will tell.
We'll see. There you go. Dasha, thank you so much. Good to see you.
Thank you for having me again.
All right, there's a Dasha Vdovina, Chief Product Officer for Toggle3D. Evan, our time has come to an end. One question that I ask at the very end is, how do you get the hat? People are asking how you get
that. contact investor relations, and they'll try and hook you up with a hat. I do want to leave a final thought. Yeah, thanks, Steve. Is that, you know, we at Nextech, we are a technology company. Period. The end. It's definitive. The stuff that we're showing you is not science fiction. This is not stuff that's in the lab. This, you saw this, over 700 users on the Toggle3D platform. There's over 2,000 users on ARway. And Nextech supplies Amazon, Target, Napa, CB2, Procter & Gamble with 3D models. And that list just keeps growing by the day. And so Nextech is really that 3D tech company, Nextech3D.ai. That speaks, I think, volumes. And we'll leave it there, Steve.
All right, Evan, thank you so much. Good to see you again, and we'll talk again soon, okay?
Thanks, Steve.
All right, there's Evan Gappelberg, the CEO of Nextech3D.ai. And I'm Steve Darling with Proactive. Thank you very much, and have a lovely day.